My name is Janet Ryan. I'm one of the librarians here at the Jones Library, and I'm so pleased to see you here on this spring day as we think about our gardens. And hopefully it's early enough that we can do some of this stuff this year. This is part of our Gardens and Gardening series that's been made possible by the Friends of the Jones Library. And this particular program has also been made possible by the Mass Cultural Council via the Amherst Cultural Council. So, welcome John Root, naturalist and landscaper. He's gonna get us up to speed on our perennial gardening.
Thank you, Janet John, Ryan, thank you. And thank you to the Jones Library for hosting this event. Thanks to the Jones Library for hosting this event. Thanks also to the Amherst Cultural Council as well as the Massachusetts Cultural Council for funding the program. So I always like to begin with this slide. We acknowledge that we live on land that was managed and inhabited before European colonization. Please take a moment to find your location on the map and honor those whose land we now occupy. Many of the plants that I'll be talking about today were in fact here before the colonists arrived. Some of them are not native, but many are. And Native Americans, of course, would have known about their usefulness and made use of them. So I'm curious to know how many of you, raise your hand if you think you have a green thumb. I'm seeing two people who think they have a green thumb in an audience of close to 20. So I'm going to ask the people who are confident they have a green thumb, in order to have a green thumb? What works?
Compost, persistence, light.
I love the way you're.
Pleasure.
There you go. I love the way you're mixing the two, what the plants need, but also what you need to have.
Yeah. And the exercise.
Right. The attitude that you need to have, which it really fundamentally it's all about desire. Because if you want those plants to happen and to be healthy and all that, well, then you'll be curious and you'll be proactive in terms of educating yourself, and you'll be, you mentioned patience and all those things will just flow from the desire. So, because those plants want to live, right? I mean, if you give them half a chance, and if you protect them from the environments who also want to have their share. Okay, so. This word permaculture is a combination of permanent agriculture that coined by David Holmgren, an Aussie author. And so it's a kind of it's a high bar, of course, to access all of our food, fiber, and energy, from plants. But the permanent part is suggestive of the fact that we're talking about perennials, not annuals, because usually when you think about gardening and farming, the traditional annual garden is the vegetables that give you a crop and then they die. But perennials keep on getting bigger and keep on giving you bigger crops. And ideally, not only do you not have to replant, but you'll get more the next year. So, these are what permaculture enthusiasts are suggesting that we can get from the plants, not only food, but drink, medicine, wildlife benefit, including an insectary, flowers that are insectaries. Some plants are nitrogen fixers, so they can fertilize the soil simply by grabbing nitrogen out of the air and converting it to nitrates into the soil. Plants can also serve as hedgerows and use them for timber. Now here's a fellow who started with a corn field, and all of his neighbors have corn fields. But when there's a drought, they're in trouble, and he is not, because he has established trees and shrubs, and he has a little ecosystem going. Animals, the perennials, as well as the livestock, and a delightful combination of plants that he's grown there. So, but you can do permaculture on a tenth of an acre, as these two fellows did a number of years ago. The humorous title of the book, Paradise Lost, and this happened in Holyoke with a tenth of an acre. That's all they had. That backyard that you see there was a virtual desert before they did what they did, and they probably added fertility to the soil and then put their plants in. As you can see, many people have passed through there in sheer delight and for their purposes of learning about the plants that they were growing and how they grow them. So the benefits of edible landscaping, even if you have a small space, here's another example of a fairly limited acreage.
Right.
But even here, they can be beautiful, functionally effective. They can even have a lot of different species, even in a small space. The prolonged harvest refers to the fact that you can have plants. Well, for example, now you could be harvesting leeks. You could be harvesting spring onions, those kinds of things. And that we're only thinking about putting our plants into our annual gardens, much less harvesting from them. And the same goes for later in the season. There are several plants that I'll be discussing in which you can be harvesting into the fall after your annual beds have pretty much given up. So because of the diversity of plants available, there's a wide spectrum of tastes and nutrients that you can have from perennials. They often are more resistant to pests, weather conditions, and other stresses than are those traditional vegetables and fruits, and they can be tremendously productive because they get bigger and bigger every year. And at the same time, provide wildlife habitat. And thinking about the fact that you don't have to replant every year, and ideally you don't have to coddle them so much. You won't have to water them. You know, these perennials, if they're well established, you probably don't even water them except for the initial establishment. And if you have them, if you have a lot of plants growing, you don't need to worry that much about the weeds because the plants have already claimed the space. So you can look at your property and think about the amount of sunlight that you have, where do you have the most sun, but don't give up if you have shady areas or more partially shady areas, because there are some plants that can thrive there. Moisture and drainage is also an issue. Too much moisture is not good. You don't want standing water. But then again, there are some plants that do quite well, at least near standing water, or even seasonally flooded places. Slope orientation is relevant because if it's south facing, then you get more sun. If it's north facing, you get less. Now, this is a diagram of the mineral component of soil, which starts out as pebbles, but then when it's, it erodes over time, you have sand, and then sand becomes silt. Silt becomes clay, which is the finest particle of mineral particle. And this chart shows you that there are different proportions of sand, silt, and clay. And the sweet spot near the bottom that says loam, that's the best combination for most plants. But that doesn't mean that you can't grow plants fine in clay loam or silt loam or sandy loam. But you can see that too much clay is more than 30% is problematic, because while clay does hold water very well, and it holds minerals very well too, for that matter, nutrients, but it can become compacted, and there can be issues with the roots getting enough aeration and that sort of thing. So you can test for your soil texture simply by putting some soil in a jar and adding some dish detergent and water, and then waiting, because it'll take a long time for that clay to settle down, And the clay would be the top layer, then the silt would be the middle layer, and the sand would be the bottom layer. You can also do a ribbon test, because it stands to reason that if it's difficult to even make a bolus, which is a small sphere, then you don't have very much clay at all. You have a very sandy soil. On the other hand, if it's easy to make a long, long, long ribbon, you've got a lot of clay. So this is a diagram that shows ribbon test would reveal about your soil. pH is an issue with soil because plants cannot effectively absorb minerals if the soil is too acidic or too basic. The acidic end is the low pH, the basic end is the high pH, and as you can see from this chart, nitrogen is absorbed quite well right in the middle, right at neutral pH, 7.0, but not so well at the extremes. And you can do a simple test of your own pH with that pH soil test kit that you see on the left-hand side of the screen. There's a little chemical that they give you, some powder chemical that you just add to the soil, then add to the water, and water to that, and then it'll reveal a color that you match to the chart. And speaking of matching to the colors, here's an intriguing thing to do. You can measure pH of anything from the extremes of 2 to 11 in this way, just by boiling a few leaves of red cabbage and for 10 minutes, and then adding a couple of teaspoons of garden soil and shaking and waiting, and then watch to see what happens. You'll have a pH test right there for you. You'll have to look it up online. Okay, what were those colors? Because you don't have this slide in front of you, but you can find it doing a test, testing your soil pH without getting prepared. Preparednessmama.com is where I got this. Now, soil compaction is probably the most problematic situation that anyone can, you know, most limiting for plants, because while plants can handle a certain amount of variation in pH or water availability or shade or whatever, but they sure cannot handle compacted soil. No moisture or air can be allowed in a compacted soil. The causes include heavy equipment or even footsteps, which, especially if you have clay soil, please stay off. You don't walk through your garden because that'll compact it. So the effects of soil compaction include excessive soil density, decreased drainage, and the remedies are either to remove and replace, right? Just start it off and start again with topsoil. Or you can bury in berms or mounds, or finally amend with organic matter. Those are three options. To test for soil compaction, you dig a hole about a foot wide, a foot deep, and fill it up with water and wait until that infiltrates through the soil. Then you fill it again after 2 hours. And if that second infiltration takes over 45 minutes, you likely have a soil compaction problem. Water should drain through a very perforated coffee can faster than 1/2 to 1 inch per hour. And another simple means is just inserting a straightened wire hanger to a depth of a foot. And if you can move it easily, then you don't have the compaction problem. But if it bends almost immediately when you try to move it, that soil is compacted, unless it's very clayey some soil. Now, a daikon radish is a wonderful vegetable that's edible. It's larger than a carrot, and as you can see, it drills holes in the ground quite effectively. So you can seed the daikon radish in there, and it provides soil cover, scavenges nutrients, and then alleviates compaction. And if you have professional help, such as this little fellow, and the right tool for the job, it's a tool called a broadfork, you can poke holes in soil. That might help too. Cover crops can also help. And there are a variety of cover crops that might do the trick. You might think that rototilling would be a solution, but here are a list of reasons why rototilling is not advisable. It causes compaction. Who would have thought, right? It actually causes compaction rather than solving it. It also causes tiller pan just below where the tines reach. If you can imagine where the tines reach, the surface down there will be glazed so that roots won't be able to penetrate. That's called tiller pan. It ruins the soil structure and destroys worm tunnels. Bad day in the garden for when your rototiller goes through. It consumes soil nutrients because all those soil particles with all that organic matter is being brought to the surface so that bacteria have a party. They have a field day and they're just going to go ahead and oxidize all of it, a lot of it. And it inverts the soil, which means the bacteria, fungi, and earthworms end up where they don't necessarily want to be. And last but not least, you certainly don't want to be bringing seeds up to the surface where they're happy to terminate. So this is the preferred means of starting a garden bed, the sheet mulch. And basically the approach is to smother the lawn or the weeds or whatever it is you're starting with, a poison, patch of poison ivy, what have you. You're just going to want to crop it as close as possible for starters. You might want to wet and moisten it. And then you put down a layer of cardboard. Now, if you don't have enough cardboard, the corrugated variety we're talking about, not the shiny kind of cardboard, but more of the, you want it, because it will be decomposing. That's the whole point, is that it'll be a barrier layer at first, but eventually it'll decompose and be part of that soil. If you don't have enough cardboard, you can buy builder's paper to roll on the lower right. You can access that roll of builder's paper at a big box store. It's sold for painters so that they can roll it out on the floor and they won't make a mess when they paint. But it works fine in your landscape as well for this sheet mulching operation. If you use newspaper, you're going to want to have at least 6 thicknesses. And in any case, whether it's newspaper or cardboard, you'll want to overlap them to make sure that the barrier layer is effective. And then after you put down that barrier layer, you cover it with mulch, and that's why they call it sheet mulching. So Wood chips would be okay, but even better is chipped branch wood. The difference being that, I'll talk about that in a minute, but let's for the sake of, thinking about mulch and what it does, it suppresses weeds, it keeps the soil moist, it keeps the soil cool, and it enriches the soil. All these are all advantages to having just bare soil. Soil that's mulched has these advantages. So here are the types of mulch. And if you have an annual bed, grass clippings are, they're acceptable, although they can mat quite easily. Straw is better, shredded leaves are better, and pine needles are actually a wonderful mulch. It's not true that pine needles make the soil acidic. It's a myth that even master gardeners haven't been informed yet, but the science does confirm that pine needles just hang out. They don't decompose for a long time. And when they finally do decompose, they don't create the acidity. Now, perennial beds, again, shredded leaves can be used, but because they decompose so readily, you might not be mindful of that and be aware that you have to reapply. Again, pine needles are fine, pine straw. Pine bark, sawdust, I suppose, would be okay. Wood chips, I mentioned. And chip branched wood is what chippers create. So a chipper, when landscapers feed branches and twigs and leaves into that chipper, there's more nitrogen than wood chips would have. Wood chips is very carbon dense and not very much nitrogen. So chip branch wood has more nitrogen, so that's a better balance. When you're growing perennials, a nice thing compared to an annual garden, you don't have to be as concerned usually about organic content. You certainly could test your soil, and right here in Amherst, there's a UMass has a soil testing laboratory. You can send them a sample and ask, if you ask for the organic content to be included in the soil test, they will tell you how much organic matter you have, and you'll also be declaring what the purpose of the soil test is. What are you growing? So if you were growing vegetables, then they might be making suggestions to really, make sure that you've got plenty of organic matter, plenty of macronutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. But many of the perennials can actually do quite well with modest amounts of those nutrients. I try to avoid buying bags of anything because there's a carbon footprint involved in producing those bags and bringing them to you. Topsoil, after all, is nothing but soil, and I can usually find soil elsewhere if I need it to fill in, as it were. Compost, well, we can make compost or we can find it. There are so many places where people dump leaves, that are raked in the fall, and then they certainly create compost over time, so you can often help yourself to those treasures or make compost yourself. Fertilizer, again, hopefully you may not even need any fertility, but buying bags of mulch may be necessary, but perhaps it could be available elsewhere if you can find landscapers working nearby. Just a little. There are ways to get free mulch that admittedly can be problematic, but the kinds that have that are advertised on the internet. But often you can avoid buying mulch as well. But please avoid dyed mulch. Come in different colors, but those colors are not good for the plants, the chemicals that create colors. Please don't excessively mulch trees. It's called volcano mulching, and there's just no excuse for it. It invites disease organisms into the tree, and once that mulch decomposes, it'll expose the roots. So there's a properly mulched tree at the bottom of the slide. Here's an intriguing form of, I guess you could call this sheet mulching, or because sheet mulching is known as lasagna gardening to gardeners who have, if you're putting in lots of layers of organic matter. And layers is what we're talking about here, the bottom layer being wood or branches and the wood we're talking about can be like old rotting logs or branches or things that you think would think would have no use at all, stumps, you may know. But if you bury this organic matter, these trees that are on their way to becoming compost, and then bury that with upside down turf or other layers of organic matter, the leaves or whatever mulch you have, you've just created yourself a garden bed, a three-dimensional garden bed. And you don't necessarily have to dig the trench as is indicated in this diagram. You can just lay out the logs and branches on the surface. And the same kind of idea is used with gardeners who have raised beds, galvanized steel that are quite high. They fill them up first with the logs and branches so they don't have to buy as much of the soil mixture, the topsoil or bottom soil mixture for the plants that they're growing. When you've selected your tree or shrub, it's advisable to dig an extra wide hole, but no deeper than absolutely necessary. The reason for keeping it as high as possible is that if the tree or shrub is planted too low, you'll have that problem with the soil or the mulch being right against the trunk, and that's not healthy for the plant. But the reason for having the wide hole is that roots usually grow laterally, right? They don't grow, sure, there might be a taproot, but most of the water and nutrients that the roots are going after are near the surface of the soil, so it makes sense for the roots to be going near the surface. So digging a wide hole enables those roots to do just that, to grow freely in all directions near the surface of the soil. And then you put the planted ground, remove the burlap if that's what's surrounding it, and return the subsoil first and then the topsoil to fill the hole. And then you would mulch, and mulch in a generous area, perhaps out to the tree line, and think about having a rim surrounding that sapling to hold in the water like a bowl. There are some hungry vegetarians out there, and through the winter, they know that bark gives them some nutrition, so that means that your precious plants could be girdled by those critters just by gnawing away at the bark all the way around, and that would kill the sapling. So you might want to consider protecting the saplings the first couple of years anyway, or indefinitely, really, no harm in that. So first, before we get into talking about the plants that you want, I feel it's my responsibility to let you know that there are some thugs out there that need to be dealt with. And these are public enemy number one, Japanese knotweed. You just can't get the roots out, no matter how much you dig, how deep you dig. There are going to be pieces of roots that will just remain, and they'll just come back, and you'll have more plants than you had before. So you can either smother Japanese knotweed after you cut it all back to the surface, to the soil surface. You can smother it with heavy black plastic and leave it there forever, like at least 3 years. And be vigilant that it doesn't try to, sneak out the sides. Or you can treat it with glyphosate, which I think is a defensible use of glyphosate. It's a topical way that it won't harm the soil, won't harm the environment when sprayed just on the plants themselves that try to emerge. After you've weakened the plants with successive cuttings, then finish them off with glyphosate. Oriental bittersweet is a nasty vine that girdles trees, it kills them. At least lop them off at the base and don't let them continue to grow up there in the canopy. And eventually, if you can uproot them, that's even better. If you don't lop them off, those seeds are eaten and dropped by birds, and they're spreading all over. Multiflora rose has made it a lot of inroads into our environment, and this takes up a lot of space that otherwise would be taken by native plants. The same goes for autumn olive, a thorny shrub that fixes atmospheric nitrogen so it can leaf out early, so it gives itself an unfair advantage. Here's another one, Asian bush honeysuckles. They're already leafing out, and they too have really established themselves way beyond what's good for the environment. Burning bush, it's no longer even permissible for nurseries to sell them. They used to be sold, but now it's well known that they're invasive. Gopweed is another one to watch out for. Garlic mustard is now blooming, and so that's why it's important to yank it out so that it doesn't go to seed. And black swallowwort is a death trap for monarchs. you know, monarch, a female monarch might lay its eggs on the leaf because it's similar enough to milkweed that it will seem like to the monarch that that's a good place to lay the egg. But unfortunately, the tiny caterpillar, when it hatches out, will not be able to eat that leaf. There's something else to watch out for out there. Asian jumping worms. They consume organic matter, they over-aerate the soil and leaching nutrients, and they cause erosion. So here's how you tell them apart from the earthworms. Their behavior first, that's why they're called jumping worms. They thrash and twitch. They are shiny, iridescent, and gray-brown, which is makes them different from earthworms. They have a milky white ring, like my tongue, instead of light red. They are mostly dry, not slimy, and they are close to the soil's surface. It's remarkable. When you see them, you think, what's that worm doing near the surface? Because earthworms stay down below unless they're brought up when the soil is saturated by water. But otherwise, they're not visible. And this is what invaded soil looks like on the left. It looks like coffee grounds. So here's what to do about Asian jumping worms. You can make a mustard solution with dry mustard and drench the area to bring them to the surface. Then you kill them wherever you find them and place in a sealed plastic bag, because there could be cocoons in there. It's not just the worms you're killing, it's also cocoons, which is why you need to thoroughly clean tools, shoes, and vehicles, wherever you might be tracking those tiny invisible cocoons around. And don't relocate plants growing in infected soil to uninfected areas for the same reason. Don't buy uncured mulch, compost, or other organic material. 104 degrees Fahrenheit is cured mulch that will kill those cocoons. Finally, don't buy infested plants. You say you have to be an informed consumer. There is always a possibility that those plants might have those cocoons in the soil, on the soil. And last but not least, the deer ticks that carry Lyme disease and other tick-borne illnesses. And one thing that I suggest is permethrin-soaked cotton balls. You can spend $50 a pop for tick boxes that do the same thing as these. The rolls of the toilet paper rolls stuffed with permethrin-soaked cotton balls, strategically placed around your property, mice will grab those cotton balls, take them to their nests, mice will, with ticks in their fur, the ticks will be killed by the permethrin soaked cotton balls. So you're helping the mice at the same time you help yourself. Poison ivy is a native plant, but of course we have every reason to try to keep it away from where we're actually actively gardening. Otherwise, though, it belongs in the woods, and the birds help themselves to the fruits in the winter as a survival food. But it's good for gardeners certainly to know what poison ivy looks like and to keep a distance. And never, ever burn wood that has some of that poison ivy vine that you see that is hairy, that sticks to the trunk of the tree or sticks to branches, because that can kill you if you inhale the fumes of burning poison ivy vine, or you could land in the hospital. So now let's move on to the pleasant topics, which are the trees and shrubs and other plants that will nourish you. And I start with this wonderful tree called the Chinese chestnut. Once upon a time, there were American chestnuts, the sequoia of the East they were, just giants of the forest, and they were feeding many animals and people. But until we are able to help them to regain their stature with breeding programs and the like, we do have the Chinese chestnut, which most of us have the room to establish. So they only get to about 40 feet tall, so that's not an inordinately tall tree. You do need at least two, by the way, for cross-pollination. Otherwise, if you just have one, you won't get any chestnuts. And this is a wind-pollinated tree. So what's good about it is, first, the nuts just taste wonderful. And they're quite versatile, not only roasting chestnuts, but also you can make chestnut meal. So think of this as a substitute for grain. It's a permaculture variety of grain in its nutritional status, as both carbohydrate and protein. You can grow in highly acid and infertile dry sands. You get a lot of nuts each year from mature trees, and it will fruit 5 to 7 years from seed. I'm not as enthusiastic about the native black walnut tree as a tree to plant on purpose for nut production, simply because you don't get that much, and it's a lot of work. And furthermore, these plants, these trees conduct chemical warfare. It's called allelopathy, and what that means is the roots secrete chemicals that inhibit the growth of the plants growing near them. So don't put tomato plants near your black walnut trees. Here are some other allelopathic trees, incidentally. The invasive Norway maple, the invasive sycamore maple, and the tree of heaven are all allelopathic. So I would rather you consider something like this heart nut or Japanese walnut. It only gets to 20 to 30 feet tall. So again, this is a manageable size. You might have room for this in your, on your property. Sweet nuts ripen in September. Requires full sun, rich sandy soil, with good range. Our best, or the optimum conditions for growth. Butternut is in the same category of black walnut in the sense that it's a huge tree and you don't get that much for your efforts. So moving on, think about that butternut and crossing it with a heart nut, which you just learned about, and you get a bark nut. I have no idea where to get these. I'm leaving you to read your resources if you're interested in experimenting with these trees. Surely someone must have them because they've been created, right? Work has been put into creating these items. Hybrid vigor, disease resistance, heavy bearing, superior hardiness. They are resistant to butternut canker, which is a problem with our native butternuts. And they only get to 40 feet tall. So. Now here's another maple, which is also huge, which also, unfortunately, even though it has delicious nuts, is not that much of a yield in terms of harvest, considering the amount of space that you have to be committing to. So, and speaking of trees that take up a lot of space, it only takes 4 northern pecan trees to fill an acre.
Wow.
That's, so you need an acre for 4 northern, but look at that. That there is such a thing as a northern pecan. You know, we're quite familiar with southern pecans, and most of the pecans grown are grown in the south. But there is a northern pecan, Caria illinoensis. And you don't need to be told how delicious pecans are. And if you don't have quite that much room, you can consider, again, a hybrid of pecan and hickory. It's still a decent-sized tree, 50 to 70 feet tall, but not quite as tall as the pecan and wide as the pecan tree would be. And Native Americans made extensive use of acorns in their diet. They are quite nutritious, 8% protein, low fat, complex carbohydrates, high mineral content, they have fiber. And the white oaks are the ones that have less tannin content. Tannin is what makes the acorn so bitter. Native Americans used to leach out the tannins either by repeated boiling or just putting them in the stream and letting the stream leach them out. So the nice thing about swamp white oak, it has virtually no tannin, so you don't have to worry about the leaching process. Hardy almond. Again, we're not used to thinking about growing almonds in New England, but there is a hardy almond that will allow you to do just that. Not only is it ornamental, but it has sweet to slightly bitter nuts, and the bitterness can be removed by roasting and salting. They are hard-shelled, they grow where peaches thrive, and it's a very modest size, 20 foot tall tree. Korean nut vine is a giant of a tree at maturity. It gets to be about 90 feet tall. And if you love pine nuts and you like making pesto and that sort of thing, I'm talking about these plants because I can assure you that they will grow here. But some of them I have limited experience with. I have no idea, for example, how you harvest those cones. Or do you just gather them in the fall and open them? They just kind of open on their own, or they'll have stuff. But if you're curious, you can go to that. The internet god, right? The internet god will tell you all about it. But consider growing conifers to the north of your dwelling to provide shelter and save on your energy. They are just as valuable as shade trees that likewise will save energy if planted to the west of your property to block the afternoon sun. Hazelnut is a tall shrub. I'm sure you're familiar with hazelnuts, how delicious they are. I'm sure you're familiar with squirrels, and you can be sure that the squirrels will discover those hazelnuts and make great use of them as well. So that's the main drawback, I think, to growing hazelnuts is how do you keep the squirrels out, or do you harvest them before they're quite ripe, and then let them harvest indoors, or let them ripen indoors. But they are delicious, highly nutritious, they thrive in a variety of soil types. And you can grow them where you can't grow much else, in a rocky slope, for example. You know, they'd be happy there. You want at least a couple of different varieties, and there are many different varieties of hazelnut, so it's something else that you do well to do some research about. What are the best varieties, and where are the best places to get them? Who are the experts? There's a company called Badger Set, and I remember Badger, the animal Badger, and then add SETT to that, Badger Set. And they seem to be hazelnut experts. Now let's talk about perennials for fruit. And speaking of sources of expert advice, there's a fellow named Lee Reich, R-E-I-C-H, Lee Reich, and he has written a wonderful book. He wrote it several years ago, Landscaping with Fruit. And many of the plants that you're about to see are featured in his book, and you will learn far more about them than I can possibly, the information that I can possibly give you in this short program. I'm just giving you a thumbnail sketch and tantalizing you with all the possibilities, but I'm leaving it up to you to learn more about them. Mulberry is more of a tree that you grow just for the fun of it and because you love birds, because birds will flock to a mulberry tree. And I love mulberry trees too, but I don't know anyone who actually gathers them and makes pie out of them or does anything else than just eating them out of hand. Chinese mulberry, again, this is an example of a tree that I've never tasted the fruit of and I have no experience with. But it's my duty to let you know that you could be the proud owner of the proud nurseryman or nurserywoman growing Chinese mulberry. You would need a male tree and a female, or at least one male and then one or more females in order to pollinate those female trees to get any fruit. But look at that flavor, a blend of ripe fig, mulberry, persimmon, even cantaloupe. I mean, I wish I could bring the fruits to you and let you sample them, my goodness. Drought tolerant is another thing in its favor. Certainly thinking about the climate changes that we're anticipating. Persimmon tree could very well be my favorite tree in the world, my favorite plant in the world. I used to live down south, and they are native to the south. But they are hardy here. And I believe they grow in the wild as far north as northern Connecticut, is what I've heard. So they do fine here, if you plant them. Just like that Chinese mulberry, they are dioecious, which means they're male plants and female plants in the wild, but there are varieties that are self-fertile. So again, doing your research to find out what those varieties are. There are many varieties of persimmon. The persimmon that you bought bought in the store is not the kind that you can buy in your home. They are not hardy. That you could grow here. You could grow them down south, they can't survive in the winter. But the American persimmon can. It's about this big, not as big as the ones you buy in the store. And you wait until it's nice and wrinkly, like as in this photo here, the upper left-hand corner. The lower left corner, it's not ready to eat. It would be very astringent. You'd spit it out and swear to never eat persimmon again if you tried that fruit. But the wonderful thing about this, remember I said that perennials will give you extended harvests, and that's the case with persimmon. They are ripe in November, even December or January. It's possible to be plucking persimmons from your persimmon tree. Imagine that. Beautiful tree as well, right? Fall foliage. So I can't say enough good things about it. And I should say, that genus Diospyros, when translated, is fruit of the gods. And they grow to a decent height, 60 feet tall, so you do need to have enough room for them. Cherries can grow also to be quite tall, and the birds have no issues in reaching the cherries, but beyond forward to difficult times. So it's advisable to get dwarf cherry trees if you're planning to attempt to harvest them. And also you're going to have a plan for giving the birds. Sour cherry, there are sweet cherries and sour cherries. Those are two different categories. Sour cherries can be perfectly good for eating out of hand, but they're also great for cooking. And the Nanking chair. Now, once again, we're helping ourselves to plants from the Orient because the Orient has similar climate to ours. And they certainly make use of North American trees, so why shouldn't we do likewise? A beautiful ornamental shrub, right? And the birds will help themselves to these fruits, but they're bound to leave something as well. Medium tart, make good juice, wonderful jelly. And here is an even smaller shrub called bush cherries. Joy Jan and Joel are varieties of bush cherries. Taste almost exactly like cranberries, although a bit sweeter, make a very good cranberry type sauce or jam. There happens to be a carnelian cherry tree or a sorbet tree right behind the library. And I've even found baby trees, seedlings growing under it in the past years. You can see it flowers in the spring before it even leaves out those yellow flowers. And in cultures where carnelian cherry is known and appreciated, they are very aware of when it's time to harvest those fruits, and they use them to good effect for delicacies. But this is actually in the dogwood genus, by the way, Cornus moss. Cornus is the dogwood genus. Now, quince is related to apple, but you certainly wouldn't want to take a bite of a quince apple that never turns color, by the way. It's always green and yellow. And so it has to be cooked in order to eat it at all. But even then, you probably want to add it to apples. You could have a quince apple pie, for example, and have just a little quince in there to give it something extra. Quince is great for, it gels very, very readily. So quince jelly, of course, is a thing, but you can add quince to any other fruit and it'll gel that fruit. It's a lot effective. It's resistant to pests and diseases, much more so than apple trees, which have to be coddled, as apple growers will tell you. And this is a beautiful tree that grows to 25 feet tall. I have some quince seedlings in a pot in the back that I invite you to take home, a couple of them, two or three, whatever, if you want any of these. I just took a quince apple, took the seeds out of it, put them in a plastic bag with something to keep them moist, and put them in the refrigerator. And then a couple months later, there they were, those seeds were already germinating inside the refrigerator, begging to live, so I put them in a pot. I'd like to share that sort of with you if you like. Flowering quince, the fruit is has a similar taste and function to the quince tree, but it's not a tree, it's a shrub. So let's talk about apples. There are some varieties that are reasonably disease and pest resistant. Liberty is one, for example, that gives you attractive fruit without spraying, has a tart, sweet flavor. Other varieties with good disease resistance are listed here on this slide. It's good to prune apple trees, to be aware of the need to keep them in good condition. And I certainly appreciate organic, a good source of nutrition. For example, there's a plant called comfrey. But if you grew comfrey around an apple tree or an orchard, there's a tremendous amount of nutrients in comfrey. So it's a chop and drop kind of plant. If you chop the leaves, they'll fall and decompose them and they'll grow more leaves. And so it's like a green manure. So speaking of organic ways to grow apple trees, here's a fellow, Jonathan Inglesby, an orchardist in Dartmouth, and he interplants with mulberry, which you saw earlier, spice bush on the left, sassafras on the right, because he knows that pest-controlling organisms will be attracted to those trees. And so he's able to grow these delicious Cox's orange pippin, for example, combining pear, melon, orange, and mango. I'd like to taste that one without using chemicals. Now, European pears are the pears that we're familiar with that you have to pick when they're still unripe. You bring them in and you wait, right? They're on your kitchen counter and you wait. And then hopefully you notice when they're just right, and then you have to eat them immediately. Even if you put them in the refrigerator, they won't keep that long, right? So that's just the nature of the European pear. And they do need a pollinator. So you can't just have one pear tree that just, you know, a genetically distinct pair that will, and they'll pollinate each other. But here's an exception to that rule of, here's a pair of the Magnus pear that keeps for 4 months, remarkably. It also is fire blight resistant and has an excellent buttery flavor. Only drawback is that it's relatively slow to bear. But again, this would need another pear tree for cross-pollinating. And if you like pears and if you like the idea of a dessert pear, a super sweet pear, and if you like the idea of a tree that's only 15 feet tall, so it's not commanding a lot of space, the Secco pear. Super sweet, spicy, and aromatic. It's so small that it's almost bite-sized. The tree has good fire plant resistance. It's self-pollinated. Okay, you only need one. And they ripen on the tree. So again, they're different from the European pear. An Asian pear is not a pear at all, really. It's no more a pear than it is an apple. It's its own fruit. And Asian pears have been cultivated for millennia in Asia, so there are just as many, if not more, varieties of Asian pear as there are varieties of apple tree. So once again, and the book by Lee Wright that I mentioned features eight Asian pears and tells you a lot about the different varieties that are candidates for your crop. So if you're not familiar with them, they can be eaten raw or cooked. They're sometimes called salad pears. You can put them in a salad. They can be eaten fresh picked, so that makes them different from your European pear. They're not frost tender, which is an advantage. They can grow to, that's supposed to be 45 feet tall, not inches, pardon the typo. And again, you would need more than two. More than one, at least two pairs for cross pollination. Peach trees are reasonably small, height 15 to 20 feet tall, and here are some varieties: Red Haven, Canadian Harmony, and Reliance, that might do well for you here in Massachusetts. People are often frustrated with squirrels helping themselves to, you know, one bite from each of the fruits, that sort of thing, and I really can't tell you what to do about that. I don't have a dog on patrol. But people often do quite well with peaches right here in Massachusetts. It's also a tree that you want to do your homework, learning how to prune. You know, and having an open, especially in the middle, it shouldn't be too crowded in the middle. Now, American plum happens to be a native fruit, and they're small plums compared to the plum you buy in the store. But they have the advantage of being hardy because they are native. They know how to take care of themselves. And you can make perfectly good preserves if you don't happen to care for the taste of a freshly picked American plum. The same can be said of beech plum, which is actually a shrub. Beech plums, as the name implies, grow in sandy soil, and they do grow on the Cape. People make beech plum preserves, and it's quite a delicacy. But you don't need to have sandy soil. You can grow it in normal soil. European plums are the ones that are good for drying, to make prunes out of, in other words. They come in different colors, as you see. Trees that grow to 35 feet tall. But it's the Japanese plums that are good for eating as a sweet, fresh fruit. You would grow two varieties for cross-pollination. They're precocious, disease-resistant, and vigorous. And they can be only 15 feet tall. So. And the lifespan can be almost indefinite if the old wood is removed and new shoots allowed to mature, but otherwise plums are not very long-lived trees. Juneberries are now blooming. This is a native tree. It's a small tree, and I often see them on the margins of woods, not so much in the middle of woods, but on the margins of woods as I'm driving along. You can see with all these common names that it must be a popular tree, and indeed it is. I can testify that fruit of juneberry is just as good, if not better, than blueberries. And birds agree, so they'll help themselves to those fruits, and they can reach them much easier than you can. I've noticed that if I'm in the middle of Northampton, next to the church there in the center of town, they've got a juneberry tree, and there are not as many birds to compete with me to get those fruits. But it's a beautiful tree in any I don't think dredge the birds there for food, so it's all season beauty has gorgeous fall foliage as well. Pawpaws are from a tropical family, the American custard apple is another common name, the flowers are fly pollinated. You do need to have two trees for cross pollination. One pawpaw tree will not give you any fruit. And they don't look all that appealing. I mean, when you see something that looks like a green potato in a tree, it doesn't get you all excited unless you're familiar with it. But when that fruit falls, it's definitely ripe. And if it feels soft and you can smell it, you know, the skin is not edible, the seeds are not edible, but that custardy pulp tastes like banana, mango, pineapple, melon, berries, etc. It is truly a tropical fruit that you can grow here in New England. Some people consider it to be the best tasting fruit in the world. It's that good. No one makes anything with pawpaws, they just eat them immediately. And they can get to be about 25, 30 feet tall. And did you know that you could grow a citrus tree here in New England? The hardy orange gets to be about 20 feet tall. It's quite thorny. And if you think about, well, what good is a lemon? Well, you can think of a lot of uses for a lemon. So if you can use a lemon, you can use a hardy orange fruit. It's got the pulp, got a lot of seeds, in that, more than you could even believe possible in such a fruit of that size. But you can use the pulp and make yourself a glass of hardy orange juice, but almost no one wants the hardy orange because they want instead the flying dragon hardy orange, and you can see why. It's just so darn beautiful. It's ornamental due to its sinuous growth habit. The photo in the lower left shows you what it looks like in winter. It's even beautiful in the winter. The stems of the thorns stay green. So there you have it, flying dragon hardy orange. The dwarf tree only gets to be about 7 feet. I'm not going to jump up and down with excitement about Coosa dogwood fruits. They're edible, but most of them don't taste that good, in my opinion. The taste differs from tree to tree. Some are better than others, but it's just not one of my favorites. However, a hardy fig tree is another matter altogether. And if you've ever tasted a fresh fig, you know what I'm talking about. Or dried figs are certainly wonderful as well. Now, even something called the hardy fig is really technically not hardy in New England because the branches will die back. The roots will resprout the next spring, but the trunk just can't tolerate the New England winter. So what the Italians do, because they love their figs, and other people who've learned from them, they'll cut. Let's pretend your body is the trunk of the tree. Well, at the base of that trunk, you're going to cut some of the roots in order so that you can lean it the opposite side into a trench that's just been dug for you, and then you're lying down in that trench, right? And then you're covered with mulch, wood chips, dirt, whatever's going to keep that plant protected, insulated from the severe temperatures of the winter. And then in the spring, you're brought back up to the vertical position so that you can continue to grow and give more figs to the humans who want them. Autumn olive is an invasive plant, as I already mentioned, right? So I just want to let you know that wherever you find them, you can certainly help yourself to fruits because they have 19 times the lycopene concentration that tomatoes have, and they're delicious, and you can make a fruit sauce, and you can make a fruit leather from the fruit sauce. However, you're certainly not going to allow them to remain on your property, much less plant them on purpose. Instead, you might be interested in planting its cousin, the gumi, or cherry silver, which has a very similar taste and wonderful nutrition as well. Nitrogen fixing, just like its cousin, the autumn olive. And it can be mixed with other fruit for various recipes. Another plant, by the way, that the birds might find quite attractive. Open itself to fruits. And perhaps you've heard of goji, or Chinese wolfberry, available in health food stores. Again, this is a plant that is hardy in New England, so you can grow it. And very high antioxidant content is part of why it's so popular. possible benefits include, are you ready? Mental well-being and calmness, athletic performance, happiness, quality of sleep, and feelings of good health. Well, is, you know, can't you trust the internet, whatever they say. But I'm sure there are good reasons to grow goji. The antioxidant content alone is well documented. And for that matter, here's another superfood, the sea berry, also called Siberian pineapple. It comes from the Orient, and if you're in China, you might be served a glass of sea berry juice instead of orange juice. So the fruit is used for juice and blender drinks, very high in antioxidants. Look at all those omegas, goodness. Anti-inflammation properties, even topical uses. It's a shrub, it's a thorny shrub, by the way. And so it can be a challenge to harvest. I believe that sometimes whole branches are removed and then shattered, if you will, to release the fruits. Quotation there, it's as if one combined fish oil with a multivitamin mineral all in one fruit. And honey berries, a fruit that most Americans have ever heard of, but I assure you the Japanese know all about them and they love them. And because they can't possibly grow enough honey berries to satisfy them, they effectively hire Canadian farmers to do that, because honey berries are very tolerant of the cold. They can be grown in Siberia. The taste of wild blueberries, that's something tangy. That gives you a little bit of a motivation to try this shrub that grows to up to 6 feet tall. Again, you want varieties for cross-pollination. Again, this is a superfruit, no question about it. Perhaps you're more familiar with currants and gooseberries. This is more of a European tradition. In fact, there used to be a rural tradition of competition of who could grow the largest currants and the largest gooseberries. A remarkable thing about currants and gooseberries is they're quite shaped tolerant. However, you're not going to get quite the yield that you otherwise would. If you're growing them in dense shape, they'll do better with at least some sunlight. But yet again, an incredible superfood with a variety of culinary opportunities. An American elderberry is a native shrub, and perhaps you're familiar with the virtues of elderberry syrup. If you're feeling on the edge of a cold or a flu, by all means, have three doses of teaspoon doses of elderberry syrup a day, dissolved in water, and I think that you will be pleasantly surprised about either you won't get the flu or it will attenuated, right? You won't be suffering as long, hopefully. But just for edibility purposes, I love to put them in my pancake batter and make elderberry pancakes, or whenever you cook with them. They don't taste that good right off the shrub. I have to acknowledge they're kind of strong tasting, right? I will nibble on them, but I certainly won't, grab handful after handful like I will other things like blueberries. The flowers are also edible. But this is, yet again, a superfood, no question. Ionite antioxidants. And birds love it, too. And in fact, it's a good pollinator plant. The flowers are good for pollinators. Now, here is a fruit that I would really like to testify. Aronia. And I'm not even putting the common name up there for you to see. But just in case you're curious, the common name is chokeberry. Now, does that sound appealing to you? There's a reason why it's called chokeberry, and that is because, just like the elderberry, when you pick it, actually it's worse than the elderberry. You eat a freshly picked chokeberry, and it's pretty astringent. But what happens when you put them into a plastic bag and then freeze them overnight, and then use them, then put, and again, I put them in my pancake batter, right? Like, aronia berry pancakes, and I can testify they are delicious. And as far as the nutritional content, they put blueberries to shame in terms of antioxidants. There's no fruit that has more antioxidant content than aronia. So the health food folks are calling this aronia berry. They certainly don't want to call it chokeberry, and for good reason, right? And it's a shrub. It's ornamental, beautiful fall foliage, and grows to about 10 feet tall. And there are improved varieties of these. This is actually a native shrub, aronia, melanocarpa. but there are varieties of improvement. You know, when you cultivate a plant for a better yield or taste or what have you, Viking is one variety that I'm familiar with. I'm sure there are others as well. Everyone, I'm sure, is familiar with both low bush and high bush blueberries. They can make an excellent ground cover. They do require an acidic soil to do well. And high bush blueberries, the one that most people grow for harvest, so that acid, acidic soil pH 4.5 to 5.2. It's a shrub that goes to about 6 feet tall. And I consider it to be an ornamental shrub. Beautiful fall foliage. So it's just an example of one of the many plants that can be grown for multiple purposes. Did you know that you can grow cranberries without a bog? It's true. And for that matter, you could be harvesting them in December. They just persist. Just like their cousins, the blueberries, they need acidic soil, less than 5. So you can grow them in normal soil. The only reason that cranberries are cultivated in bogs is that nothing else can grow in bogs. And so you're making use of that don't have to weed the other plants out of the way. You just put your cranberries in. Lingonberry, another relative of the blueberry. This is a plant that's native in Sweden. So lingonberry preserves are very popular there. Popular here for people who know about them. Unquestionably, yet again, a super fruit, another one that requires acidic soil. And now, incredibly, the fruits can be kept for months at room temperature in jars of water. Now, who ever heard of a method of preservation of fruit being simply dumping them in water and letting them sit there on your kitchen counter? I mean, or stirring with a small amount of sugar, no cooking required. It's a shrub that only gets to be about a foot tall. There are many varieties, again, of lingonberry. So if you like the idea, explore and try a few different varieties and see what you like. And raspberries do grow in the wild. The black raspberry is quite common here in New England. But there are improved varieties of black raspberry, as there are other colors, the purple, the yellow, the red. A tip to suggest if you have a few of these raspberries, and I do recommend that you invest in the improved varieties, because they'll give you more than the native black raspberry will. But you can just bend the cane over and anchor it to the ground, or it'll do this on its own often. You just bend it down, and then it'll grow another plant. It'll root where it's in contact with the soil. And if you just snip that off, you've got a new plant. But you can encourage the process if you like. You could even bury an entire cane, essentially, with letting the leaves still be above the surface, but the entire cane would then root out. And you'd have many plants just from that one cane. It is possible to have a variety called Chester, which is thornless, a variety of blackberry, and any blackberry picker will tell you that you're risking your life out there trying to pick wild blackberries. They're quite thorny. So thornless blackberry is an attractive option. And there's so much to know about growing strawberries, including the fact that there are day neutral strawberries and June bearers, and they're grown differently. And I recommend Norse Farms in Waitley as a source of both plants and information about growing strawberries. You also might be interested to know that there are alpine strawberries, smaller than your cultivated strawberry, but they're very sweet. They bear all summer, which is an advantage, and they're an attractive ground cover. Another ground cover is the white woodland strawberry, which has the advantage that no animal, hopefully, is going to recognize it as being ripe, even when it is. And delicious and hint of pineapple. This strawberry is unusual. It has no runners, but it'll clump, and so you'll be able to divide the clumps and spread them around that way. Now, here is a fruit that, if you've never tasted a hardy kiwi, I predict that the first time you taste it, you're going to be in ecstasy, and you'll wonder why no one has ever given you a hardy kiwi to taste before. They are that good. They're just wonderfully sweet. They are small, they are green usually, sometimes with a reddish tint, but usually they are green. And just like the persimmon, when it has a nice, smooth, firm skin, it's not right here. You wait until it's kind of wrinkled a little bit, where it's until it's soft. And that's when you pop it in your mouth. And there's no seeds to worry about. Okay, so it's totally different from that kiwi that you're familiar with that has that rough skin that's inedible. No, you just pop the whole fruit in your mouth. It's a small fruit, smaller than a grape, really. But we are talking about a vine now. This is not a shrub or a tree, it's a vine, which means that you need support for the vine. And you need a lot of support if you want a lot of fruit. And you probably do want a lot of fruit. And you need at least one male, because they are dioecious. So you need one male plant that has male flowers to pollinate however many females. You know, one male vine would be sufficient for maybe six or seven, you know, pollinating six or seven different varieties. But there are many varieties, again, many varieties of hardy kiwi that have been developed and that are worthy of your consideration. But it all starts with support, right? You need to have some kind of trellis or arbor. They've been grown as ornamentals, and people have imagined people not even knowing that they had a delicious fruit that they could actually eat because they're just not familiar. There's also something called the super hardy kiwi, hardy to minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit, not that we need, but it's a super hardy kiwi. It has the additional advantage that it only needs 130 frost-free days to ripen, so it'll ripen earlier. Now, remember I said that there's the benefit of these perennials that they often give you extended harvest. This is another example of a fruit, just like the persimmon, that is, and the pawpaw, for that matter, is also a fall. So too are hardy kiwis. They're ripe in October. Now, there are many varieties of grapes that I would consider far superior to the grapes that you're able to access in the store. Store-bought fruit, after all, is usually all about size and appearance. That's not what you want. You want the taste, you want the nutrition. So consider varieties like Himrod, Stoyman, there's so many more. And once again, of course, being a vine, it needs support, and you need to know the basics of how to tend to those canes, or to those vines. Now, Shisandra, Chinese magnolia vine, also called five-flavor fruit, because there are five flavors that we can detect. Sweet, sour, salty, bitter, and savory. Those are the five flavors. And this one happens to have them all. And it is a vine, okay? And a remarkable vine. And if you're an athlete, perhaps you're aware of Shisandra, because this word adaptogen, perhaps you've never heard this word. It means it's something that gives resistance to diseases and stress, increasing energy, increasing physical performance and endurance. An adaptogen is not hyperbole, this is a real thing that actually has these health benefits. And consider point number two, providing a mental boost without the jitteriness caused by caffeine. Now, if you had been brought up with Shisandra, you would certainly feel that you couldn't be without Shisandra, just as people all over the world feel without coffee. But according to the claim here, right, which is pretty well substantiated, it gives you the benefits of mental boost from caffeine without the side effects of the jitteriness, and sort of without the concern about the health consequences of drinking too much, etc. So I don't have time to run down this whole list. I'm just saying that even if 15% of them are true, you've got a lot of good reasons to grow Shisandra vine. This is another plant, by the way, that you could cultivate, because you just let the berry parts of the vine, instead of giving them support, you allow them to root, and then you'd have many plants to give away to friends, family, neighbors, whoever you want to be generous to, and spread the wealth. Everyone else can have their Shisandra vine as well. And the rugosa rose, often growing on the Cape, is an edible fruit that has a lot of vitamin C. You can just eat that fruit fresh, or you can make preserves, or you can make rosette tea. after you dry the things. Now let's talk about vegetables. And Eric Tomsmeyer, you might recall, was the co-author of that book, Paradise Lot. And he currently is living in West Hampton and has started a much larger, he has purchased a much larger property than the 1/10 of acre he had in Holyoke. And he's now going beyond what he was able to do in Holyoke. So if you can contact him, just if you remember his name, right? And do a search for him. He's doing a lot of education about permaculture and growing a lot of these wonderful plants. And you can see, and he's a wonderful author and a great person. So that's his book, Perennial Vegetables. And so many of the plants I'm going to talk about are covered in his book. We're all familiar with asparagus as a perennial vegetable. It takes quite a while for an asparagus bed to get productive. It takes years, right? And you have to weed it quite faithfully. And rhubarb is the other perennial vegetable that most people are familiar with the stalks being edible, the leaves are not. Well, how about ostrich fern, which is a native fern? And people talk about fiddleheads, right? You can buy fiddleheads in the store. Every fern starts out as a fiddlehead, but it's only the ostrich fern fiddlehead that really is going to be worthy of your consideration, your culinary consideration. And you can see that it tastes earthy, like tree ear mushrooms, even savory, satisfyingly crunchy, sometimes chewy. Now, these are majestic ferns that grow in the wild in moist areas, perhaps seasonally flooded areas, and they handle shade quite well where they grow. But if you give them a spot out in the sun, they'll be happy and they'll grow even better. And they'll spread. You know, they'll form colonies and form more colonies. So you don't want to start harvesting those fiddleheads until you've got a good-sized colony going. But that's certainly an option. Jerusalem artichoke is in the sunflower family. It gets to be about 10 feet tall at least. This is a giant perennial. All of this growth is in 1 year. It just dies back at the end of the year. But just think of it as a very tall sunflower with smallish sunflowers. Blooms, but the blooms are not while you're growing. It blooms in October, which is delightful to have such a late blooming plant. But it's the tubers that you're interested in. As you can see, they can have variety of shapes and they can be big. They can be boiled, fried, or roasted. Tastes slightly nutty and savory, like a cross between an artichoke and heart, and the best potato you've ever had, according to one source. However, they can cause flatulence and even just gastric distress. So you have to be cautious with them. You have to perhaps be mindful of how much you eat the first time, you know, and do a little taste test or stomach test. There are also ways to alleviate the gastric distress or alleviate the risk of it. And one way is to pickle them. And another way that I've read about but haven't tried is to soak in lemon juice and or slow roasting. So give that some consideration. But you know, a Jerusalem artichoke patch they love sun, and they'll just keep going. So you don't want to grow them anywhere near your garden or you know anywhere where you don't want them to invade, because they will. They'll just help themselves, right? So having been forewarned, I've got some Jerusalem artichokes for you to help yourself to in the back of here if you'd like to bring some home. Giant solemn seal. I've never tasted them before, but Eric Tomsmeyer assures us that these shoots taste like asparagus with a cucumber flavor. I would never harvest them in the wild because it's a wildfire that's probably not all that abundant. But if I grow them, I can harvest what I grow. I've never even seen a chordate spikenard or hudo, another name for it. Young shoots are in spring. They require moisture. They like partial shade. It's a pretty tall plant, isn't it? Now you're doing a double take, right? Now, this is a show about edible vegetables. Why is he to have a slide about hostas? Well, because they're edible. They're a Japanese mountain vegetable. And indeed, in the spring, which is now, right, or soon, maybe they're not quite big enough yet, but soon they will be ready for you to pick. Ask any deer. Any deer will tell you. Any deer will tell you these hostas are delicious, right? I think they're overused ornamentally and for landscape purposes because you know no one ever does use them for vegetables. But they're not a native plant, but anyway, give them a try. Spider work.
Excuse me?
Do you cook them or eat them raw?
Yes, young shoots taste, yeah. I'm sure you would cook them. I'm sure you would cook them. I have had them. I'll throw them in my stir fry. They're perfectly good.
Oh, wow.
So spider wood, fairly common flower grown in front of this. It can get pretty rambunctious too, but very young shoots and leaves can be chopped and added to salads, soups, and stews. Even the flowers are edible for that matter. You can put in the salad. Now here's a remarkable plant. Those leaves really do get big. Japanese butterbur, sweet coltsfoot, fuki. Mm. And so it's all about, well, if you're in that culture, you know, if you're raised with this being a delicacy, then, you know, I want my fuki. the stalks of these leaves, the stalks are rolled against a cutting board with salt to loosen the skin and to reduce the bitterness. Then they are boiled. For your information. Yes, question?
Is that any coltsfoot? Because...
Oh, so the question is the name coltsfoot. There is a wild plant called coltsfoot, which is much smaller. Much, much, much smaller. The wild coltsfoot can be almost invasive. But I say almost because it's really a native plant, so it belongs here. So technically no native plant can be called invasive.
I don't think it's native.
Oh, you don't?
No.
I'm not sure. I stand corrected then, perhaps.
I'm not sure.
I'd have to check that. Maybe it's not. I'm just so used to thinking that it's belonging here. Maybe it doesn't. Good King Henry is a relative of lamb's quarters, which is an annual weed, which I love because it's better than spinach, and it's free, and it grows abundantly on compost piles and in farmers' fields. So during lamb's quarters season, I'm always on the lookout, and I'll harvest bags full of lamb's quarters, but you can grow a perennial cousin of lamb's quarters, Chenopodium bonus henricus, Good King Henry, that also tastes like spinach. The flowers are even edible, and the seeds can be used like poppy seeds. Now, lovage is like a celery on steroids, right? Flavor like parsley and celery combined with a hint of aniseed and curry. Bamboo is an edible vegetable. Ask any Chinese restaurant, right? Bamboo shoots are part of the vegetables that they serve, one of the vegetables. And bamboo are certainly hardy here in New England. You do want to be mindful of the fact that they will spread very aggressively. A lawnmower will cut them short. I mean, they can't keep on spreading if they're mowed. The woods will also prevent them from spreading. They can't march into the woods. They can't tolerate it. But you don't want to be a bad neighbor and plant bamboo right next to your neighbor's lot, right? Let it march on. But anyway, there it is. Perennial vegetable, you can eat bamboo shoots. And Eric Tomsmeyer says that he really is fond of perennial chicory. The rich, nutty, and bitter flavor of their leaves is a fantastic addition to gourmet mesclun salads and is tasty in many gourmet dishes as well, according to Eric. There are varieties of chicory, both annual and perennial. And one of my favorite perennial vegetables I've been harvesting for several weeks now is dandelion. If it didn't grow in the wild, I would probably grow it. But because I don't need to, I don't. But that's just how much I love dandelion. It's just such a delicious and nutritious green. And not surprisingly, improved varieties have been cultivated, have been bred for cultivation. And you can buy dandelion greens at Whole Foods, for example. It's a thing, right?
Do you cook them?
I love dandelion greens in salads or cooked. Most of the dandelion greens I grow, I do end up cooking. But I can say that when I'm going for a walk, I'll just eat one leaf after another. Raw. I'm like a grazing cow. and I can't think of any other green that I'll eat that eagerly as dandelion. Some people consider them to be bitter, but the thing is that, well, for one thing, perhaps it's an acquired taste to a certain extent. If you're used to mild greens, then yeah, you're going to experience it as being strong. But also they get more bitter after they flower. So April is the month, and they're already, depending on where you see them, they might already be, it might already be too late, or you might at some places find plants that haven't flowered yet, or barely are flowered. Now, here is a remarkable vegetable native to the coasts of England. Can you imagine a lush plant like that growing in the rocky coast? And so a native plant enthusiast in Britain says, I place it on a palm and set scallops and truffles in the Parthenon of wild fruit gardens. And he goes on to sing its praises, right? So many things that it's a versatile vegetable. But they don't need to grow there. You can grow them in normal soil. Just like you can grow beach plum in normal soil that you don't need sandy soil to grow. Here's another versatile vegetable, Turkish broccoli. Flowering heads are a mustardy broccoli. The young leaves are eaten raw or cooked. The older leaves are cooked as mustard leaves. And how about climbing spinach? There is actually a Facebook group devoted to Caplitzia tannoides. That's how much people love this plant and want to know all about it and how to grow it. So no other perennial edible is anywhere near as productive so early in the season, which certainly recommends it highly, doesn't it? You know, to have all those, that vegetable, all those wonderful greens in the early spring. And because it's a vine, climbing spinach, you have to figure out some way to let it climb, to give it some support. European cuisine often includes common garden sorrel. It's a lemony, sour taste, right? Leaves, tart, and lemony, higher nutrients. Used in salads, soups, and stews. So this is a perennial vegetable you can consider. Groundnut is a native vine. And the downside of groundnut is that how in the world do you harvest it? I mean, those tubers on strings, it's kind of like a necklace. You know, think of it as an underground necklace. A tuber and a root. A tuber and a root. It just keeps going and going and going. Now, how are you going to know where to find them unless you have grown them in area where in the substrate, the soil, where nothing else is growing, there are no competing roots. And for that reason, they can be harvested along a riverbed or something, and they're just pulled out, you know, and then you can get, or perhaps if you find them growing in a bed that's well mulched, and they happen to have found that bed, and that's another opportunity. But groundnut was an important survival suit for food for colonists. First year in Plymouth that they were here. Tubers, 16% protein, slightly nutty flavor, so they're more nutritious and better tasting than potatoes. And they can be boiled, fried, or roasted. And speaking of tubers and roots, how about salsify? The leaves also can be cooked, you know, eaten or cooked, but it's the roots that people would usually grow them for that taste like artichokes. Skirret, another root vegetable, which is also versatile because the shoots as well as the leaves can be eaten. But the roots are eaten raw or cooked, tastes like a nutty potato or a mixture of carrot and licorice. There's skirret. And then there's Chinese yam. And Chinese yam, not only does it make those wonderfully large tubers, but there are aerial tubers as well, as you've seen that person's hand. They grow right on the vine. This is a vine, so it does need support. Baked yams taste like baked potatoes and crisps, great for kids. Kids of all ages, including everyone here. Okay, mint root, Chinese artichokes from the Orient. This is a mint, a plant in the mint family, but the tubers do not taste minty. They're pleasant, delicate flavor, reminiscent of a mixture of apple, clove, artichoke, new potatoes, and buttered chestnuts. Intriguing shape of those tiny little tubers. And I wish I could pass that plate around and give you a taste. There are a number of onions that are perennial. One of them is the Egyptian or walking onion. The way it walks, as you can see in the photo, those bulblets form at the top of the stalk, and some of them will sprout and make more stems, which means that the plant bends over, and then those bulblets at the tip of the second stalk will simply plant themselves. So you have a plant that walks around your garden and appears all over the place. So it's edible, the leaves, and then it's edible now, right? Leaves and stems are used in salads or cooked dishes. They have a strong and hot onion flavor towards the leaves and stems. The bulbs can be used like shallots and have a mild flavor. And then there's balsam, which has such a delicate flavor that I recommend that you don't, that you wait until the last moment to add them, you know, because they can be overcooked. But it's a beautiful, the stalks are hollow. It's an intriguing plant, and just beautiful. Leaves used in salads or cooked dishes like spring onions. Stems used like leeks. Bulbs used as shallots or small onions. Perhaps you've heard of multiplier onions, such as shallots and potato onion. Another perennial onion. Perhaps you know about chives. That's perennial too, right? Young leaves have a mild flavor. They can be used raw or cooked. They can be dried and frozen. Flowers are used in salad. Beautiful plant. There's also something called garlic chives, or Chinese chives. Quite versatile, leaves, stems, and flowers. And flower stems are tender with a great mild onion garlic flavor. Used in salads, stir fries, dumplings, pancakes, soups, and kimchi. Flowers are added to salads and cooked dishes or dried and browned as a spice. And a bed of garlic chives really commands the area. You can think of this as a ground cover. If you define a ground cover as something that won't allow anything else to grow, and for the same reason you could call Jerusalem artichokes a ground cover, a 10-foot tall ground cover, because nothing is going to grow under that Jerusalem artichoke patch. It's just saving everything else out. Garlic is a perennial vegetable. If you don't harvest it, you leave some in the ground, it'll keep going. Wild leek is perhaps the most delicious onion of them all. It grows in the wild. And because it's so delicious, high-class restaurants will pay a lot of money for wild leeks. And because they pay a lot of money, a lot of it's been over-harvested from the wild. You can grow your own wild leeks and not worry about over-harvesting because you grew them. And I'm growing them right on a sunny south-facing bank, which is funny because this is another example of a plant that can only be found in the wild in shady woodland areas, kind of above the skunk average, right? Not as moist as skunk. That's where you typically find wild leeks. But if given a chance to grow without competition in sunny areas, thank you very much, and it'll grow quite well. So on to consideration of herbal teas such as lemon balm, which is a mint, and catnip. These are two very calming teas, useful for insomnia, for example, or if a child has insomnia. Them some lemon tea or lemon balm or catnip tea. Peppermint and spearmint are from them, right? Uses a peppermint and spearmint. Mountain mint. Surprisingly, this can be a mosquito repellent if you, and this is true of other mints. You take some leaves and rub them on your skin, and the mosquitoes won't bother you for maybe 15 minutes, half hour or so. But, and it's a fantastic pollinator plant. Doesn't look like much, right? This small white flowers, but I assure you, if you have a patch of mountain mint, you will have a lesson in entomology. All these wasps you've never seen before, all these butterflies, all the, you know, bees, everything's going to show up on your mountain mint patch. Here's another very valuable pollinator plant, in addition to being useful as a tea, wild green one. And as teas, again, I mentioned that roses can be used for tea. Now, I'm sharing this slide, Missouri Botanical Garden, simply because this is a great internet resource. If you just remember Missouri, and then you type in the name of the plant that you'd like to learn more about, such as the one I mentioned earlier, black chokeberry. Remember that name that I didn't want to speak? So, or Aronia. Okay, so if you're curious about that plant, you'll find out, find its height, you know, its own, where it'll grow, where it's native, the height, okay, it goes to 360. Tall, it's great, 3 to 6 feet, and then there's a bloom description, what are the conditions it grows to, and then the garden locations, you can find out where to get it. Hopefully, that may not be an exhaustive list, but it is quite helpful to find it. So, that's an excellent source of learning about plants. Learning about edible plants, PFAF, Plants for a Future, PFAF.org. We'll give you the edible rating, they have an edibility rating. Uses of the weed potential medicinal rating and how to care for them. Now I'm suggesting that these are some local nurseries, I cannot certainly, I can certainly not claim that you can find even half of the plants that I've talked about in this presentation at these nurseries. But they're a place to start. Blank's Evergreen Nursery in Hadley, Gardner's is fine in Hadley. Norse Farms is great for fruits and a variety of other plants. I think they also have asparagus and rhubarb and things like that. Triple Root Farm in Southampton is good for permaculture plants, as is Turtle Bend Farm in Montgomery, a new farm that has just opened up, a new nursery. So, permaculture principles, people are excited about permaculture because it's a fact, I'm sure you'll agree, that we certainly could grow enough food for everyone on the planet. It's just a question of having the priority to do that. Care for Earth, fair share, care for people are all principles of the permaculture movement. There's no planet B. Thank you for doing your part, and I'd be happy to entertain any questions or comments that you might have. Yes?
I have a question. So, I know your bibliography makes reference to a couple books about forest gardens.
Yeah, an edible forest garden is another way of saying permaculture.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Okay. Somehow in my mind, I thought a forest garden was a garden that you plant in the forest. Is that not?
No, it's not that.
Not
edible forest garden implies that you're replicating a forest ecosystem.
Oh, I see.
Because a forest includes all, you know, large trees, small trees, shrubs, vines, and wildflowers. Ideally, it has everything. You know, it's a multi-layered system. So that's the idea. That's why it's called an edible forest. It's a kind of a permaculture way of talking about edible landscape, making use of all the strata.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. And do you do consultations? Or if somebody moves for advice on?
Yeah.
Okay, cool, thank you.
And don't forget that I have brought Jerusalem artichoke tubers and 80 quince trees if you want to take any of those home.
Thank you.
Thank you.